We have been told a simple story. DHT causes hair loss. Block DHT and keep your hair. Sounds logical, right? But if that's the full truth, then blocking DHT should stop the hair loss for everyone, yet it doesn't. If the DHT is the real cause of hair loss, why do some people with a high DHT never go bald, while others do? And most importantly, why do people who take exact same dose of finasteride experience completely different results? One of the biggest misunderstandings in hair loss is the idea that DHT alone is a problem. In reality, hair loss is context dependent, and DHT often is the aggravator of already compromised follicles. Today I want to break down for you whether fixing scalp inflammation alone can help you to reduce DHT sensitivity, and how inflammation and DHT actually interact, on my current take of finasteride, and whatever hair loss can be stopped without direct DHT blocker. So first of all, will fixing scalp inflammation help to reduce DHT sensitivity? Short answer is yes, but it also depends. DHT sensitivity is amplified by scalp inflammation, and when scalp is inflamed, blood flow is affected, fibrosis increases, immune signal around the follicles become more aggressive, and androgen receptors become much more reactive. To give you context, what happens if you plant a healthy seed in toxic soil? It doesn't grow, and same with the follicles, it's no difference there. Reducing scalp inflammation helps reduce the activity of the follicles, but it doesn't erase genetic factors or factors internally that can cause more DHT sensitivity. Here's what inflammation does on the follicle level. It increases DHT mobilization around each individual follicle, and it is also increasing DHT concentration on the regrowing alopecia area. Right? So what happens here is there is more androgen receptors in a top on the scalp compared to other areas, and that increases, like a sensitivity increases DHT mobilization and DHT concentration in that area. And it also triggers mast cells, and it also leads to microfibrosis around each individual follicle, like more like a microinflammatory problem. And this again creates a vicious loop, so we have a scalp inflammation, more DHT signaling around the follicles, more inflammation, more mineralization, and that loop continues. And this is why people who have, for example, seborrheic dermatitis, excessive sebum, excessive oil pulling, psoriasis, chronic itching or redness, often experience much more aggressive hair loss, even if they are taking medications such as finasteride, compared to those who doesn't have those problems. So what is my current take on finasteride? Finasteride works, but it works in a narrow way. It lowers systemic DHT. By doing so, it helps reduce androgen mobilization, but it does nothing to fix scalp inflammation, reverse fibrosis, increase blood flow, restore mitochondrial functions, or heal gut-skin connection. With other words, finasteride is a symptom-managing tool, not recovery strategy. It can slow down the hair loss, even stop the hair loss progression for several years. But for others, it can create a new problem, such as side effects. So big question here is, can you stop hair loss without direct DHT blocker, such as finasteride? And yes, many people can actually do it when the hair loss is driven also by inflammatory responses, by immunoreactivity, sebum production, nutritional deficiencies, gut problems, poor mitochondrial functions. When you reduce your inflammation, normalize sebum, improve circulation, lower oxidative stress, support follicles itself, DHT becomes much less destructive, even if it is still present. Remember, DHT exists for everyone, but not everyone goes bald. So now let's talk about DHT sensitivity and DHT mobilization, which is key to understand. And this is also where most people get confused. DHT sensitivity is caused by factors that causes more androgen sensitivity to the follicles. And DHT mobilization occurs because follicles are weakened by that high DHT sensitivity. So blocking DHT doesn't fix sensitivity, it just lowers DHT levels. So if there are factors that keeps levels elevated or spikes them, then finasteride or other DHT blockers lose its power over time, or it may not work at all. It's about sequence and strategy. If you lower DHT without fixing inflammation, results can stale. If you fix inflammation first on DHT sensitivity, DHT itself becomes much less powerful and you end up needing less direct DHT blocker, if at all. And if you are new to the channel, my name is Alex, and I'm someone who was struggling with hair loss for almost a decade before I was able to recover my own hair. And now at age of 31, I have better hair than I had in my early 20s. And if this all makes sense for you that I spoke about in this video regarding DHT sensitivity, DHT mobilization, DHT concentration, and scalp inflammatory problems, and you don't want to waste time and energy to connect all the dots yourself, then what I would suggest for you to do is to get hold of rapidly a formal workbook where I have laid out whole strategy how to address the hair regrowth and get actually hair results in terms of hair recovery. And you can find the workbook itself below this video, there's a link for it. Thanks for watching this video, guys. Let me know in the comment section what you found useful in this video and what strategies you're going to implement in terms of your hair loss situation. We can catch up there and see you next video.